we're going to go ahead and pray, and we're going to get started. Father God, we thank you so much for this day. We thank you, Father God, that even amongst all the craziness in our world right now, Father God, you remain steadfast. You remain on your throne, and you are not surprised by anything that that has come our way this week. The hurricane did not surprise you. The power outages and even the assassination attempt yesterday for former President Trump did not surprise you, Father God. So we just ask, Father God, that in your sovereignty, that you would just give our hearts peace to know, Father, that you are in control of all things, Father God, that you already have the outcome in the palm of your hand, Father God. We pray that you would just continue to lead us, to guide us, and that, Father, our hope would be in you and nothing that this world has to offer, Father God, but that we would firmly stand on your word and your truth and the promises that you've made to your people. Father, I pray that you would open our hearts, our ears, our eyes, Father God, today to just receive everything that you have for us, Father God. We want to hear from you. We're expecting to hear from you today, Father God. We thank you for the praise team that they are willing to come and give of their time and their talent to lead us into your throne room this morning. Father, I pray as we sing the songs that it would be prayers from our hearts to your ears. I pray for Pastor as he leads us in the teaching and the preaching of your word, that you would use him as your mouthpiece, that, Father, he would step aside and that you would come through, Father God. We thank you, we love you, and we praise you. It's in the strong name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God.
Hey, everybody. Good morning.
Morning.
We're going to do something a little different this morning. Woo-hoo. I want to read a couple of verses to you. Ephesians 5:19-21. Speak to one another in psalms, hymns, spiritual songs, singing and making music in your hearts to the Lord, always giving thanks to God the Father for all things in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, and submitting one to another out of reverence for Christ. And also Romans 16:6. Greet one another with a holy kiss. All churches of Christ greet you. So there's more than one way to praise the Lord. We do a good song at times. I'd like for everybody to get up and say hello to your neighbor and greet them with a...
Yeah.
Oh, Oh! seated this morning. You know, I was reminded as they sang at the cross this morning about what the Apostle Paul says in 1 Corinthians, when he says that the message of the cross is foolishness to them that are perishing, but to them that are being saved, it is the power of God. And, you know, I was just thinking that, you know, what that means in context is, you know, the message of the gospel, Jesus Christ, God Himself, God incarnate, coming down, taking on flesh and taking on humanity, becoming weak for us and making Himself a sin offering for us. The very idea that Jesus is our propitiation is that Jesus came and He bore the sins of the world upon Himself and took the full weight, the full penalty of the judgment that was due to us because of sin. Jesus took that upon Himself, and He became sin for us that we might become the righteousness of God. And church, when we look at that and what Paul was saying in 1 Corinthians, that the message of the cross is foolishness to them that are perishing, but to them that are being saved, it is the power of God. Our salvation is complete through Christ Jesus, and our faith in that, trust in that finished work. It's not that we're being saved, it's just the gospel is still saving. It's still doing its work. And church, is something that we should be so grateful for, that the message of the gospel, Jesus' death, His burial, His resurrection, His willingness to take our sins upon Himself and to pay that debt in full. That's why we're here this morning, church. Amen. That's why we praise. That's why we worship. And in church, it's worthy of our worship. Because the God that we serve is the God who came down and gave Himself as a propitiation for our sins, to make Himself a sin offering for us and to be our substitute. It's a glorious thing, church, and worthy of our praise this morning. Amen.
Amen.
It's also worthy of our recognition that God is our provider of all things. Everything that we have is a gift from Him. And this morning, as we give of our tithes and offering, let's do that in remembrance that He is our provider. Okay? Let's bow our heads and let's pray. Heavenly Father God, we are so thankful, Lord, just for the gift of Christ, Lord. His willingness to step into our place, to take our debt upon Himself and to pay that debt in full. Lord, there's no need for any other sacrifice. Jesus is the sacrifice that has paid that debt in full, Lord God. Thank you. God, we thank you for your consistent faithfulness and your continued provision for every need, Lord. And Father, we just want to pray over the offering this morning, Lord, that you would bless it, multiply, God. Use it, God, for your glory, for your kingdom work, Lord. God, just pray for your wisdom and counsel, Lord, as we seek your heart and will in all things, Lord. Lead us. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Church, listen, let's go ahead and dismiss our children next door for children's church. There is nursery provided. Is that correct, Haley? Nursery, yes. So nursery is provided next door as well. So if you have any nursery age children, Haley and Ashley will be taking that group this morning. So, and can I just recognize Sherry, Ashley, and Haley this morning? They do such a great job. Thank you for their service and their sacrifice. Listen, I first of all just want to thank you all for allowing our family, our whole family, to take a vacation this past week. It was such a blessing for us. Had all our kids and all our grandkids. So it was a wonderful thing. My parents asked me, so they were like, "So did y'all have a relaxing time?" I said, "We had fun." I don't know how relaxing it is with seven children running around, but we had fun. And yes, we had a relaxing time because Nikki and I, that's our greatest joy right there, other than the Lord, of course. But just being with our family was such a blessing. So thank you all. Thanks, Tom, and for Doug, for filling in for me. I know that, you know, it wasn't planned that way, but we had the whole praise team, you know, take vacation all at once. So, but man, it was good to get away. So just thank you guys for that opportunity this morning. We're going to pick up right where we left off, right back in the book of Matthew, the Gospel of Matthew in chapter 6. And we're going to be picking up in verse 16 through 18. We've looked so far here in chapter 6, looking at Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. We looked at so far about doing our charitable deeds before men, and Jesus says we should not do it before men, but we should do that before God. We looked at prayer and our, you know, Jesus' instruction to us in regards to prayer, that we're not to pray before men, but we're to pray as we're praying to God in that secret place, right? This, as an audience of one. And then we looked at that example prayer that Jesus leaves us, the Lord's Prayer. Lord, walk through that and what that should mean to us in regards to Jesus' example prayer. Today we're going to be looking at fasting, okay? And that's where we find ourselves here in verses 16 through 18, okay? And what I want to do this morning is typically like we always do, okay? I want to read verses 16 through 18, these passages that we're covering this morning. We're going to take a moment to pray, all right? And then we're going to do it again. We're going to break this down this morning, line by line. So beginning with verse 16, are you there this morning? Have y'all found it?
Amen.
Acts chapter 6, okay. Beginning with verse 16. Jesus says, "Moreover, when you fast, do not be like the hypocrites with a sad countenance, for they disfigure their faces that they may appear to men to be fasting. Assuredly, I say to you, they have their reward. But you, when you fast, anoint your head and wash your feet, your face, so that you do not appear to men to be fasting, but to your Father who is in the secret place. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you openly." All right, let's bow our heads and let's pray. Heavenly Father, God, just so deeply grateful, Lord. God, thankful for Jesus. Thank you for your gift of salvation, Lord, of eternal life that is found in Him. The Bible specifically tells us that it's by grace that we are saved through faith. That it's not a work of man. It's your work done and accomplished through your Son, Jesus Christ, and our faith in that finished work, God. Thank you for that gift. God, we thank you for the opportunity to gather here this morning, Lord. God, we thank you for your presence that is here with us this morning, Lord. And for your Spirit that leads us into all truth. And I just want to pray, Lord, that your Spirit would speak today. God, that you would help us to lay aside any distractions that we brought in this place with us this morning. From this past week's events, which there was so much that happened this week. Father God, we just want to pray, Lord, that we might be able to separate all of that today from our minds, Lord, and just focus here today, God, on you. Lord, I pray, Lord, that you would anoint and bless the preaching of your word here today. Lord, use me, speak through me, fill me with your Spirit, Lord. I just pray that your Spirit speak today, Lord, and that I would be silent, Lord. So, Father God, we thank you for all that you have planned, that you continue to do in our lives, Lord, and the work that you're accomplishing here, Lord. It's such an honor and a privilege to be a part of that, God. Thank you. God, we love you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
So, looking at this verse in context, right, these three verses in context, talking about fasting, all right? First of all, we need to understand what fasting is and what it is meant here in this context. The word fast comes from a Hebrew word that means to abstain from food. And in context, that's what Jesus is speaking of here in regards to fasting. Now, that doesn't mean that that's the only way that we fast. Now, I believe that this is the primary way that we fast. And if you look at it throughout the scriptures, in most cases, probably 99% of the time when the Bible mentions fasting, it is speaking of abstaining from food, all right? Food and liquids other than water. And that's kind of the context for which we're looking at here. Now, there's other ways that other examples that we see in ways to fast. Any sacrifice that we make in order that we might separate ourselves for a time and focus ourselves and our attention on prayer and seeking the Lord is going to, He's going to bless that, okay? But this is speaking of abstaining from food. And Jesus says that when you fast. Now, this isn't a command. We don't see a command given to us in the New Covenant to fast. But I think that we can take, we can understand here that here Jesus has taken the stand on. He assumes that his followers will fast. It's the same as we looked at beginning with verse 1 of chapter 6, looking at doing our good deeds before men. He says in verse 2, he says, "Therefore, when you do your charitable deed," okay? Looking at prayer in verses 5 and 6, Jesus says, "When you pray," okay? And here we see he says, "When you fast," all right? So, Jesus assumes that his followers will fast. And so there's a purpose, and I think that we can understand that fasting is important in the life of a follower of Jesus Christ. That it's something that we should practice. Now, I'm not saying that we're always faithful in it. I can tell you that I'm not. But I think that we can see here that it is important that we fast. There's been times and seasons in my life through my walk with the Lord that I've been pretty consistent with fasting. And it's usually when I'm faced with a circumstance and a situation that I recognize, man, I need to be deep in prayer for this. And fasting is that way in which we humble ourselves before God. And we show our seriousness and our need for God's intervention in whatever circumstance and situation that might be. I was listening to a sermon by Derek Prince. I'm not saying that I follow him. I don't really know much about him. But I was listening to this sermon yesterday in regards to fasting. And he says the primary reason that we fast is to humble ourselves before God. He says, and the Bible says that we're to humble ourselves before God. And he may mention that, you know, that it's not a good thing to pray for God to humble us. Now, God will humiliate us if we are bound up with pride and going our own way. But we should, everywhere where the Bible talks about humbling ourselves before, he says, humble yourselves before God. And so when we fast, we are humbling ourselves before God. And we always see the two things connected, prayer and fasting. Now, you can pray without fasting, but you can't fast without praying. The two are connected. Everywhere that you see mentioned in the scriptures in regards to fasting, prayer is connected to it, okay? Because fasting, it is showing the seriousness of our hearts. It's us setting our flesh aside for a time, for a season, in order that we might turn our full attention towards God and express our deep need for His intervention, whatever that might look like. And I think that I want to mention just a few examples that we see in Scripture of great patriarchs of the faith, even Jesus Himself who fasted. We see that Moses fasted for 40 days before receiving the commandments from God. That's found in the book of Deuteronomy, in book chapter 9 and chapter 10. We see that David fasted and mourned the death of Saul, the king, his king before him. We saw that he fasted over his son Abner. We see that he fasted over his child that was taken from him after his sin with Bathsheba. That is found in 2 Samuel. We see that Elijah fasted for 40 days after fleeing from Jezebel in 1 Kings. And we also see that Esther fasted for 3 days before approaching the king in Esther in chapter 4. And in Daniel, we see that Daniel fasted for 3 weeks, for 21 days to seek God's guidance. And we also see that Jesus Himself, the Son of God, right, came and He fasted for 40 days in preparation for His temptation in the wilderness. And we see that the early church in Acts, that they fasted before sending out missionaries. Now there's reasons here that we can see that they fasted. Moses fasted in order that he might separate himself for a time so that he could hear from the Lord and get direction. We see that David fasting a while, he would mourn for this loss that he felt in his heart and in his life. We see that Elijah fasted whenever he was faced with a circumstance and situation that was beyond his control, when he had lost hope and he decided that there was none left, no other prophets left, and everyone was against him, and all they did was seek to kill him. And he fasted. We see that Esther fasted for the purpose of God preparing her for a time when she would have to face the king, which she put her life at harm's way in doing so. So she fasted. We see that Daniel fasted for God's guidance. And we see that Jesus fasted for 40 days in preparation for his temptation in the wilderness, that God would hold him strong and that sort of thing. And then we see that the early church fasted over the missionaries, over the apostles that were about to be sent out. They fasted in their choosing of the apostles and they also of the missionaries, and they also fasted for their sending out in order that God's covering and protection would be with them, and that God would bless their efforts as they went out and they spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. There's many purposes and reasons for which fasting is needed in regards to our walk with the Lord. And we also see here that it's not designated to a certain amount of time. There's nothing here that we see that Moses and we see that Elijah and Jesus, they fasted for 40 days. We see that Esther fasted for 3 days. And then we see that Daniel fasted for 3 weeks. It's not a set aside time of amount of time that we are to fast. It's whatever the Lord puts on your heart. And so we see that we have a need for fasting. In fact, we have these examples that were mentioned here just now, but we have throughout the scriptures in Old Testament and New Testament where prayer and fasting is mentioned. Okay? And then we see in context Jesus here speaking of fasting, and he says, when you fast, as though he assumes that his followers will fast, that they will separate themselves from that fleshly need. And I can tell you, it's a sacrifice, right? It's probably more of a sacrifice for some of us than others. Nikki says, I get hangry sometimes. She knows if I get in a bad mood, it's time to feed Randy, okay? I love food. I always have, right? And I think that many of us can say, man, when we get hungry, our first response, man, I need to eat. So whenever we fast from food, I mean, it's a sacrifice. It is a denying of ourselves, a denying of our flesh. It's humbling ourselves before the Lord. And the Bible tells us if we humble ourselves before God, He will lift us up. All right? And I can tell you that from experience and those times of fasting, man, that first day is super hard. The second day's pretty hard. But listen, God sustains us. And church, like I said, it's a time of humbling ourselves before God and expressing our great need for Him in that moment. Now, church, we need to understand about prayer and fasting. You know, I want to remind us of what we learned the last time I was with you when we were talking about prayer. That in Jesus' illustration of prayer, what it is, He says that we're to pray that Thy will be done. Okay? When we seek God in prayer, all right, we're not trying to convince Him to do something He has and that is against His plan or His will, but we're lining ourselves up with the will of God, and the same with fasting. We're not forcing God's hand to move in our situation. We're coming in agreement with God, and we're laying it down before the Lord, and we're saying, God, I accept Thy will. But we express it with great faith and obedience to the Lord, and we humbly come before the Lord, and we submit ourselves unto Him, and we say, God, I need You. And that's what fasting is. It is coming before God and it's expressing our need for His intervention and whatever that might look like. Whether it's us seeking God's counsel and direction, whether it's us seeking His protection over a situation, whether it's seeking Him in times of great need and anguish in our life, whatever it might look like. Prayer and fasting go hand in hand. And we come to the Lord in prayer when we fast. Church, we're humbly submitting ourselves to God in those circumstances. But He says, and then Jesus kind of gives us, kind of like the same way with which He did in regards to our charitable deeds and our prayer, right? He gives us the right way to do it, and He gives us the wrong way to do it, right? And we see that here in regards to verses 16 and 17 and verse 18. But in verse 16, Jesus says that when you fast, do not be like the hypocrites with a sad countenance, for they disfigure their faces and that they may appear to men to be fasting. Assuredly, I say to you, they have their reward. In other words, church, when we fast, right, we don't make it known to people. We don't walk around all discouraged and sad and like we live life out normally. Now, Jesus is speaking of those, right, those religious people who wanted to make sure that everybody knew that they were religious people, right? That they were important and that they had this special relationship with God. That's why they did their charitable deeds in front of men to be seen by men so they could receive the praises of men, right? That's why they prayed in front of people with such bold and unique prayers so that they could be heard by man and receive the praises of men. And in the same way, they would fast and they would make themselves, they wouldn't take baths. They would just be so in the presence of society, they would just, it would be evident these people are fasting. And Jesus says, don't be like them, right? Don't be like the hypocrites. In other words, don't put on an act. Don't put on a mask. Don't try to make yourself look some way that you're not. It's not for the purpose of gaining attention from men. And he says, if that's your intention, if that's your focus, if you're doing your charitable deeds before men in order that you might receive praises from men, if you're praying before men that you might receive recognition from men, if you're fasting before men just to be seen by men, he says, then you've received your reward. Right? You got your pat on the back, your accolade. And Jesus says that is your reward. So there's a right way to fast, there's a right way, and a wrong way. The wrong way is that we are not to do it before men and make it known to all. It's a commitment, and it's a situation where we're humbly making ourselves, putting ourselves in a position that we can truly, intimately hear from the Lord. And that's why Jesus says later on that we meet God in that secret place. And I want to get there in just a moment. But then Jesus says there is a right way that we are to pray. I mean, that we are to fast. In verse 17, he says, but you, when you fast, anoint your head and wash your face. And the idea is there is that you take a bath, all right, clean up. Don't look like you're fasting. Look normal. Put on your normal routine and go about your business. Because the act of fasting isn't meant to impress people, impress man, but it's an act that is between you and the Lord, and you're humbling yourself before God. And you're seeking God on a deeper, more intimate level. It is true surrender. It's a denying of oneself. A denying of one's flesh so that we can draw near to God in an intimate, special way. And that's why he says in verse 18, he says, so that you do not appear to men to be fasting. They shouldn't even know. Now, there may be circumstances that are unavoidable where you have to tell somebody, sorry, I'm fasting. But it's not something that you are to make known or public just because you're looking for the attention of men. He says, so that you do not appear to men to be fasting, but to your Father who is in the secret place. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you openly. In these three circumstances, in regards to doing our charitable deeds, in regards to prayer, and in regards to fasting, Jesus says that there's a secret place that we're to do it before the Lord, to an audience of one, not to be seen or recognized by men, not to impress people, but for the purpose of meeting God in that secret place. And, you know, this has been heavy on my heart after studying this, reading over this for the past several weeks, is this idea of the secret place with God. Right? This place where we can meet God in this intimate place, this intimate level. And aren't you so thankful that we serve a God who desires intimate fellowship with you and I? Yes. He's not this far off, avoidable God that just He doesn't want to be near to us. No, the Bible tells us in James that if we draw near to Him, He draws near to us. And James would add to that we draw near to God with clean hands and a pure heart. Right? There's a right way to draw near to God. There's a right way to meet God in this intimate, secret place. And you cannot enter that place with pride. That's why it's important that we humbly come before the Lord. When we have pride in our lives, when we are doing things in order to get recognition from man, we have received our reward here. The church, it ain't worth it here. It is not worth it. Everything, every treasure that we will look at this next week, but every treasure we gain here, it's perishable. It lasts for a moment. But church, the treasures that we should be stored up with the treasures in heaven. Where dust and moth cannot destroy, thieves cannot break in and steal. Jesus is saying that there's an intimate place that we can find with the Lord, a right way to approach Him, a place where we can enter in and experience the fullness of His presence and His in our lives. And can I tell you, church, there's no greater joy than being in the presence of the Lord.
Amen.
Everything else will leave you empty and broken inside. It might satisfy for a season, but it only lasts for a little time. You'll get your reward here, but church, that's not what we're here for. It's not what we're here for. And church, we should be praying, God, I humble myself before you. I want to talk to you a moment about that secret place. And you know, I started looking at different passages in the Bible that speak, and I can tell you, man, there's so much in the Old Testament and the New Testament that talks about a secret place with the Lord, a hidden place, a place where we can find refuge, a place that we can find shelter, that place where we can meet God on that intimate level, that place where it's just truly that connection between you and God, and it's a place of great joy and great peace. And Psalm 91 is one that really stuck out to me. I shared this with the group yesterday at men's breakfast. Man, we had a great time at men's breakfast. If you're unable to be there, I want to encourage you, listen, try to be there if you can. It's just a great time of intimate fellowship with just men, man. We're just having time of intimate fellowship with one another and growing in relationships. And we had a great crowd. We had to move out of there and we had to come over here because we had so many. So what a blessing it was. And it's just men from other churches, you know. Can I tell you that we belong to one church?
Amen.
Amen.
We belong to one church. And that's the church of Jesus Christ. We are His body. The church is not a building. It's not a structure. It is believers, those who have placed faith and hope in Jesus Christ. But that gathering is so important. But we sat down in this circle, kind of like we did on Wednesday nights, and I just shared with them these two verses that really spoke to me that yesterday morning. The Psalm 91, and we'll have it up here on the screen, in verses 1 and 2. The psalmist writes, "He who dwells in the secret place." And the idea is those who dwell in that secret place, those who come and they make that place their inhabitation, that's their home, where they spend that time in that secret place. It says, "Of the Most High." Of the Most High. The Most High comes from the Hebrew word Elyon. And Elyon is a name, a descriptive name that's given to God by the Hebrews to describe that He is the supreme God. And can I tell you what that means to us, church? Is that God invites us to live with Him, the supreme God. And what it means there, church, we'll look at this in a moment too, is that there is no other God. There's one God. Isaiah wrote, God speaking through Isaiah says, "I am God, and there is none other. There are none besides me." We serve one God. He's the supreme God. And He says, "He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide." And there again, that word abide means to lodge or to dwell, to live there, to make it our home. He says, "Under the shadow of the Almighty." And Almighty comes from the Hebrew word Shaddai, which means Almighty. And that's who God is. He is supreme. He is Almighty. And He says that we can abide under His shadow. Can I tell you, church, if you're gonna be in somebody's shadow, you can't be too far away from them. You gotta be near them to abide in their shadow. I gave them the example of, you know, I've grown up my whole life from teenage years into my adulthood. Most of my adulthood I have spent, you know, in the landscaping industry. I spent most of my adult career outdoors, working outside. And we did a lot of new construction. And I can tell you, most of the times when we pulled up to a job, there was not a shade tree on the job site. And I can tell you, those were the jobs you dreaded most, because in that summer heat, when you're working out in that heat, you want shade. You want something that can cover you and protect you, right, from the heat. And I can tell you, when we pulled up to those job sites and there was trees there, we were thankful. Because the shade, the shadow of that tree protected us from the sun and its heat. And church, that's an example that we have here. When we abide under the shadow of the Almighty, church, is that we're under His covering. We're under His protection. You see, we are under Him. And church, there's no greater place to live. If you're out there on your own and doing it your own way and living it your own life, and you're denying Him, you're denying the very thing that is there meant to shelter you and to cover you and to protect you. I don't know how men make it without Him. don't. But then in verse 2, he says, I will say to the Lord, and the Lord there, and the Hebrew word is Jehovah, Jehovah. And it means self-existent, eternal God. God's not a created being. He's eternal God. He has been, he's always been, he always will be. There's no beginning and there's no end to him. That's why whenever Moses cried out, who do I tell you, who do I tell them that sent me? He says, I tell them that I am sent you. Tell them that the eternal God, the self-existing God sent you. And then he says, he, the supreme God, the almighty God, the self-existent, eternal God, he is my refuge and my fortress and my God. In him will I trust. And all God's people said amen.
Amen.
We abide under the shelter of the Almighty, under the shadow of the Almighty, church. Just know that we're trusting in someone far greater than we are, far greater than anything, any person that we could ever experience or come in contact with here on this earth. So why would we not submit to him? Why would we not surrender to him, knowing that he's the all-sufficient one, the one who covers us, who protects us, who provides for us, who gave us the ultimate gift, eternal life through faith in his Son, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us. In Romans, it tells us that God demonstrated his love towards us, that yet while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Can I tell you that you can come to faith in Jesus Christ and know that the work has been finished for you? And you can come just as you are. You don't clean yourself up. You don't try to make yourself better to receive that gift. It's a gift. And it's received by grace through faith. And he simply says, come. Enter in. And church, let me tell you, the great benefit of being a follower of Jesus Christ, of being his child, the Bible tells us that his Spirit testifies with our spirit that we are children of God. Right? It's more than church than an acquaintance that we have between us and the Lord. It's, man, we've entered into his family. We're his children. And we've been grafted in. And there's great benefit that comes from that, church. And church, when we pray and when we fast, we humble ourselves before God. We're meeting God on that intimate, secret level, that place where it's just you and him. Now, we can do that, like I told you, in prayer. It doesn't mean that when Jesus says that we're not to pray before men, that doesn't mean that we don't have public prayer. That means that even in our public prayer, man, your heart is turned towards God, and it's an intimate prayer that is happening between you and the Lord. It's about that connection that God so desires for us to have with him, and that for which we are such in need of. And so often we are just unaware of it. I shared with the group yesterday that I was on a mission trip with a pastor from Mississippi, and he's a pastor of a large church there. I think they have 2,000 to 3,000 in attendance, 3 or 4 services on a Sunday. And he told me, and not that that means anything, and he'll tell you that, but he told me, he says, on that trip, he said, Randy, he says, there was a time when my daughter was sick and in the hospital, and the doctors were telling me that they weren't sure she was going to pull through. And he says, you know what? He says, that was the first time I really realized just how little control I had. And church, I think that if we really realize how little control that you and I really have over our lives and over our circumstances, if we really realize that, then we would really realize our need for God, who is sovereign, who sits on his throne and he reigns over all his creation, and he never loses control. I can tell you, we've seen a lot of chaos this week.
Yeah.
Haven't we? It's been one of those weeks. The hurricane, the attempted assassination of the church. Can I tell you, it's not because God is out of control.
That's right.
We live in a fallen world plagued by sin, and And church, those things come along with that, but that doesn't mean God's out of control. God is still working His plan. And He will bring it to completion. And you and I are part of that plan if we've placed our faith and our trust in Jesus Christ. That's why, church, when Jesus says, pray that thy kingdom come. Man, Jesus, there's coming a day when Jesus will come. He will come for His bride. And church, He will come and He will establish His kingdom here. And the Bible tells us that we will rule and reign with Him. Why do we invest so much into this when we have that to look forward to? Why do we resist Him here to try to benefit from these things that are temporary and passing and fleeting when we have that eternal reward awaiting us? Jesus says, come. Come. Would you please stand this morning as we go into a time of invitation? The invitation is simply this morning, church. Come. Humble yourself before God. I don't know what your situation is. I don't know what your circumstances is. But church, I can tell you, I don't care what it is. You need to be in that secret place with the Lord. Whatever that looks like for you. And for me, I can tell you, like I said, this is just knowing that there's that intimate place that we can find with the Lord. That place where we can truly be connected to Him. And that place where we can be under the shadow of the Almighty. To experience Him in an intimate, personal way. There's nothing like it. Invitations open as they play through this song. And if you need prayer this morning, I'll be here to this song. Would you please come? In Jesus' name.
Yeah.
filling the bags with the different things that we've got for the homeless ministry this immediately after church. So if you're able to stay and participate in that, that'd be great. Many hands accomplish work quickly, so let's just think about that. But other than that, I mean, let's pray, and we'll dismiss with 1, 2, 3, hallelujah. Heavenly Father, God, we just want to thank you, Lord, for your love, your grace, your mercy, God, just your presence, Lord. We thank you, God, just for your plan. Lord, we trust you in all things, God. And know, God, as the book of Romans tells us, and Paul says, that you work all things out for the good of those who love you and are called according to your purpose, Lord. God, thank you. God, we give you all praise this morning. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen.
1, 2, 3.
Hallelujah.